For those of you who may be a guest this morning, my name is Brad. I'm the lead minister here, and I'd love to shake your hand after the service. I'll be right out in the entryway, so please make it a point to come up and shake my hand and introduce yourself. That would be awesome. We are currently, right now, in the second week of this series called Better Together. We're talking about relationships, doing life together. Part of our mission is to connect people relationally with God and with each other and with those inside the church and outside the church. And we're getting ready, August the 7th, to launch what we're calling Wednesday Night Small Groups. Okay, maybe you heard about that a little bit. We've been talking about that for quite a while. I know that many of you have signed up. I'm really excited about it, and I want to make sure and communicate. You can't over communicate some of these things. If you're signed up for a Wednesday Night Small Group and you're just not exactly sure how that's going to work, here's the one thing you need to know. This is it. Okay, this is the one thing you need to know. Wednesday, August the 7th at 6:30, come in this room. This is where it's all going to start. And after that, it'll all be self-explanatory, okay? We're going to start our evening here together every Wednesday and then break out into our groups. It's going to be really, really cool. And so we've been talking about the fact that we're better together, about relationships, about connectedness. And last week, we talked about this idea that we need each other. We do. We just do need each other. We're created by... Think about this. We're created by a God whose DNA is relational to the core. A relational God created us in his image as relational people. We crave relationships to do life in relationship with him and each other. And we thrive when we're in those relationships. Even though it's not always fun, we challenge and push and make each other better when we're together in the church, and we shrivel up spiritually, and we struggle when we disconnect or, you know, detach, or I can't say that word. What's the word I'm looking for? Yeah, detach. There it is. Thank you. Excellent. So this week we're going to talk about the Jesus model of discipleship. The Jesus model of discipleship, which was intensely relational. And I can't wait to share that with you. Grab your message notes. It's a little insert in your bulletin if you're not used to that. All the scriptures are there, some blanks you can fill in. I always put three talk it over questions at the end of that so that you can get together some friends, have a little impromptu small group, go through those questions and talk about living this out in your life. The Jesus model of discipleship. I want you to think about this. Jesus had 3 years from the beginning of his ministry, his baptism, till the point of his crucifixion to fulfill the Father's eternal plan for the redemption of mankind, right? And to launch, have a movement ready to launch that would stand up in the face of whatever the Roman Empire could throw at it in terms of persecution, stand up against the gates of hell, as Jesus said, my church will, you know, even the gates of hell will not prevail against it, and will spread the good news of redemption and the kingdom to the ends of the earth. No big deal, right? It's only the biggest event that's ever happened or ever will happen in human history. You know, for me, anyway, the best way to get a sense of how big a deal this was is just think for a few seconds about this question. How would you do it? Yeah. Only took a second for a few humps to come in there, right? It's like 5 seconds in, I'm overwhelmed. Here's how Jesus did it. This is so cool. So counterintuitive. So awesome. He started a small group. That's what he did. He came and he picked out 12 guys. See, because here's the deal. Jesus instinctively understood that as awesome as worship services like this are, it's great to get together. The church has been doing this from the very beginning, large groups gathering together to sing praises and proclaim Christ. And as awesome as Bible studies are, man, I'm an advocate for studying Scripture. Jesus knew that worship services and Bible studies alone would never produce the kind of disciples that he needed to launch this movement and change the world. It just wasn't going to happen there. He needed to form a group that he could do life with, that he could go through the ups and downs with, that he could teach how to live in a rhythm of life and relationship with the Father and what that looked like, that he could do on-the-job training with day in and day out. So in Mark chapter 3, verses 13 and 14, here's what we read. Jesus went up on the mountainside, and he called to him those that he wanted. So he's calling the disciples to him, right? And they came to him, and he appointed 12. Now look at this next line. This is huge. That they might be with him. If you're taking notes, underline that. That they might be with him. Friends, that's the key to pretty much everything in the Christian life. Abiding with Christ. Being with Christ. Think what's wrapped up in that little line is, he called 12 people to be with him so that when he woke up in the morning, they'd be there with him. When it came time for lunch, they'd do lunch with him. They'd go through the afternoon. They'd do supper. They'd go through the evening. They'd go through the ups of life and the downs of life. When he's serving and ministering, they'd be right there with him, watching him do that. When they're opposed, when they're challenged, when there were struggles, they'd be right there with him in the midst of that. They'd laugh together. They'd cry together. He could challenge them and pour into them that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach. Jesus sets the example for us in exactly how to go about making disciples. Jesus understood just instinctively that he could preach to the crowds, but if he wanted to make life-changing, world-changing disciples, he had to get smaller. He had to get with a group of people that he could do life with and relate with and pour into like this. And so Jesus calls these 12 men to do every day with him for 3 years, to nurture them and love them and teach them and pour into them. Discipleship is the crux of the church. Making disciples is the crux of the gospel. It's the core. It's at the core of the Great Commission, and Jesus shows us exactly how to do it. Okay, so in preacher style, I've got 3 points for us this morning. Okay, Jesus had a 3-point plan for making disciples. I love this. Step number one, the first thing Jesus did in the model of Jesus's plan to make disciples was invite. Invite. Very simple. It's not rocket science. It's the easiest thing in the world. Hey, how you doing? Hey, why don't you gotta come check this out. Hey, we're going to this place, our group. We got a group of people that we get together on Wednesdays. We talk about the Bible and encourage each other. And we're going to a park this Thursday. We're gonna have a picnic. You guys ought to come out. That's pretty easy. You know, hey, we're starting this new thing on Wednesday nights. Come on out and check it out, and you might make a good friend. Inviting. Jesus was a master inviter. In John chapter 1, it opens up with John the Baptist talking to his disciples about the fact that he needs to fade from the scene and Jesus needs to become larger. And at that moment, Jesus walks by and a couple of those disciples of John's follow him, and he turns and says, what's going on? And they say, where are you going? And he says, come find out. Come and see. Come check it out. Jesus was all the time saying, just come and find out. This was with so many of his disciples, he would approach them and just say, come follow me. Jesus invited people in to relationship. This is how he started it. This is so cool. Jesus understood something that, if you'll think about it, it's probably very true of your story and your walk with the Lord as well. Jesus understood that belonging very often precedes believing. Think about that. Belonging, knowing that you're accepted, knowing that you're loved, often precedes belief. Connection precedes conversion. Relationship precedes revelation. Getting to know people, getting to see Christ in their life opens the heart to the work of God. This is exactly what happened in Peter's life. We love Matthew chapter 16, the great confession of Peter, right? You are the Christ, the Son of God. It's an awesome moment. Well, listen to this. Let's read this. Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 17. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do men say the Son of Man is? They replied, well, some say John the Baptist. others Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But who do you say that I am? Jesus asked. Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah. Just in case you're curious, Messiah is the Old Testament word for Christ in the New. They both mean anointed one, the Savior, the one, the promised one, the one who will come and deliver God's people and establish God's kingdom. You are the Son of God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. Now, Peter didn't get this on day one. Peter didn't get this in the first month. Peter didn't get this in the first year. This is a couple years into walking with Jesus and with the disciples. It was relationship with Jesus. It was belonging. It was hanging with the disciples, watching the Lord, living with him, experiencing that, that opened his heart to receiving this revelation from the Father. Belonging so often precedes believing. Relationship opens the door to revelation and taking steps of spiritual growth. So true in my life. 1987 was the year that I surrendered my heart to Jesus. I've told you parts of this story before. Famous grandma quotes all over the place. You know, she was the woman who loved me and loved Jesus in front of me all of my life and prayed for me all the days before I received Christ. And so when I hit bottom, you know, I ran to her and I sat down at her kitchen table. I said, Grandma, my life is a mess. Words that she'd been waiting for me to say for a long time. Because she saw it coming. You know, have you ever seen that in somebody's life? You're like, that day's coming. I had figured out a way to drill a hole in the bottom of the barrel and go under it so that I had to look up to see the bottom. I mean, it was bad, right? And I said, Grandma, my life's a mess. And she said, Brad, you were bratty boy. She said, you got to get out of Anderson. You've got to leave this place, because she knew that I had all these influences around me. You've got to leave. Sometimes I'm not telling you have to do this, but you know, be aware. I had to do this. I had to fly out of there. She said, you need to go to Wichita, Kansas. And the reason was is because I had some family who were really plugged into ministry out there in a church called Central Christian Church. And I flew out there. Nobody there knew Brad from anybody else, from Adam. All they knew was Aunt Doris and Uncle Maury's nephew's coming and his heart's open to Jesus. And when I got off that plane, they just loved me from day one. Nobody cared about where I'd been or what I'd done. They were just glad I was there, and they poured into me and they were kind to me, and I belonged. I belonged. I was accepted. It was a beautiful thing, and that acceptance and that belonging opened my heart to believing. It paved the heart for me to open up and say, yes, I want this Jesus that I see in these people. This is awesome. Relationship. It's the key. It's the beginning. This is why we're inviting you to step into a small group this fall, to step into a smaller group of people where you can begin to intentionally, on purpose, get to know each other's name and story and talk about life and talk about the Bible and begin to go through life together and build relationships. This is why we're always going to encourage all of our small groups to be inviters, to be inviter groups, to be looking out for new people that you can encourage to do things as a group that get us out of the building so you're just doing fun things. But fun things can be kingdom things, because they're great opportunities to say, hey, come check this out, and let people experience a little belonging. And you never know what the Holy Spirit might do with that. Jesus understood that relationship this way with each other opens the door for relationship this way with the Father. It's powerful. So the first thing Jesus does when he wants to make disciples is he invites people in. Number two, love. Love. Jesus said, okay, I'm inviting you in, and then he began to love them. Now, you got to understand something about Jesus at this point. You've got to understand that for Jesus, love was way more than a feeling. Love was way more than a sentiment. Love for Jesus was a relational verb. Okay, now if you're taking notes, I think that's worth writing down. Love for Jesus was a relational verb. Love for Jesus was all about how we treat people, especially when we don't feel like treating them that way, right? It's all about how we treat people. Paul describes the kind of love that Jesus poured into the disciples really well in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We know this chapter is the love chapter. But now think about this, verses 4 through 8. Think about this in terms of Jesus pouring himself into his disciples. Love, Paul says, is patient. Someday, grab one of the Gospels and read through it and just make note of every single time that Jesus is patient with the disciples. When they're slow to get it, when they're a little slow to come along, and you can thank God every time you make note of that, that he's patient with you too, right? And patient with me. When you're patient with someone, guess what you're doing? You're loving them. You're loving them. Love is patient. Love is kind. When you're kind to someone, especially when you don't want to be, you are loving them. And that's a Holy Spirit thing, right? Love does not envy. It doesn't say, oh, I wish I had what they have. It says, praise God, thank you that you bless them. That's awesome. And thank you for what you bless me with. It doesn't boast. It's not proud. It doesn't dishonor others. It's not self-seeking. Think about Jesus walking with the disciples every day, and they get to see the rhythm of his life, how he gets up every day and pursues his Father and pursues the kingdom and how he interacts with people. And they understand, they come to understand, this is the Son of God who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped or clung to, but he checked out of heaven and became a servant, emptied himself, and was born here among us to pour his life out for us. You talk about not being self-seeking. You talk about love. And the disciples, as they walked with him, they began to catch glimpses of this and see this. Because faith is so caught more than it's taught. This is why Jesus wanted to get with them and do daily life with them, because he knew they needed to catch some things. There's some things you can go to 1,000 classes and Bible studies and worship services and you won't catch until you start walking with people. And you start seeing it, and it starts becoming part of your life. Love isn't easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Praise God. Love does not delight in evil, but it rejoices with the truth. Jesus was always forgetting yesterday and pushing and pressing the disciples away from the things of this world and toward the truth. Toward the truth, toward who the Father was, toward the kingdom. Love always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. It always perseveres. It never throws in the towel. It never gives up. So Jesus calls these 12 to do some things that we read about in the epistles later. To forget tomorrow, let tomorrow go, and keep pressing on toward the kingdom. To let go of their old life and to step into a new life with him in this group. And through some time with him and experience with him and him pouring his love into them, as we just described, nurturing and caring and sharing and pointing them toward truth, these disciples began to understand what it looks like to wake up every day and choose to follow Jesus as Lord and Savior. See, after 3 years of walking with him, they knew what it was meant to wake up and say, there's Jesus. Let's watch and see what he does this morning. Let's go through this day with him. Let's go into this evening with him. And everything they experienced, they got to see how Jesus handled himself and walked. And so they caught the rhythm of life that Jesus had. They caught the attitude he had toward stress and worry and trusting the Father. They got to see it. And so they learned what it means to walk with him as Lord and Savior. And they began to understand what it means to love each other the way Jesus loves us. That's our goal for our groups. That's our goal for our groups, that we might grow in a deeper understanding and challenge each other every time we get together to embrace what it means to follow Jesus daily as Lord and to love one another. So Jesus invites, and then he loves, And then, step three, he commissions. He sends them out. I almost my outline for this message was almost bring them in, build them up, and send them out. Because that's kind of I kind of made it a little bit too, I don't know, I didn't seem too trite, but that's powerful. That's what he's doing. He's inviting people in, building them up, pouring into them with his love and fostering and creating an environment for belief to come alive and nurturing that through love, and then saying, all right, now go repeat that process. Step number three, commission. You've been invited in. You've been loved. You've come to belief in me as Savior and Lord. I've poured my heart and life into you. I have taught you. I have cared for you. I've challenged you. We've been through ups and downs together. Now you go and do the same thing with another group. Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20. Now this is after the resurrection of Jesus, right? He comes to the 12 and it says, then Jesus came to them and he said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Just for notes, that's all the authority there is. Okay? So, all the authority has been given to me. Therefore, in that authority, never forget that you're an ambassador. That it's not about your authority. It's about the one who sent you. Okay? So therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you, and surely I am with you even to the very end of the age. Go to your friends, go to your family, go to your workplace, and invite. Invite people to be part of something. Something your group's doing, invite them to check out something that's going on here at church. Invite them to say, hey, we're doing Kids Alive this week. It's really awesome. You ought to bring your kids out. It's going to be awesome. Or what? You know, just invite. It really is that simple. And then let belonging do its work. Give the Holy Spirit. You're just creating an opportunity for the Holy Spirit to do what he does best as he shines through you in your life and the community of believers. And then love them. Love them. Serve them, care for them, point them toward truth, be patient with them, let God do his work, and as they grow up, then commission them to send on out, to go on out. It's kind of like that little line on the bottom of your shampoo bottle. Rinse and repeat. That's kind of it. Come to Christ, grow up in Christ, send out, bring another group in, bring them in, build them up, send them out. It's awesome. Now, Matthew chapter 28, verse 20. Jesus says something here that I just don't want us to forget or overlook. And surely, that means absolutely you can go to the bank with this. This is a done deal, okay? And surely, I am with you always to the end of the age. Friends, as you invite and as you love and pour into people and as you participate in this process, and encourage each other and challenge each other to go out and be commissioned, Jesus is right in the midst of the whole thing. And listen, here's what Jesus does. Jesus takes care of all the inspiration. You don't have to worry about these things right here, okay? Jesus takes care of all the inspiration, all the convicting, all the illuminating, and all the drawing. You don't have to open up people's hearts to the truth. You don't have to draw them to the Father. You don't have to convict them of their sin. That's the Holy Spirit's job. All you need to do is love them and invite them. Love them and invite them. Get them into context. Let them experience what the community and with God's people is like. The Holy Spirit will do the rest. You might have to open your mouth at some point and say, hey, would you like to take this step? Can I answer that question for you? All that. But Jesus takes care of all the heavy lifting. Now, next week, we're going to look at the next chapter in this. What happens after the Great Commission? What happens in the early pages of the book of Acts? How did the early church embrace this commission to go and invite and love and commission one another and do ministry together in groups and care for each other in community like this? Really looking forward to that. Because the bottom line is, what I just described to you is what changed the world. It's what turned the world upside down. And the gates of hell couldn't stand against God's people inviting and loving and commissioning. So how do we respond to this, man? What do we do with this? Well, I got three suggestions for you. First off, be open to whatever the Holy Spirit's saying to you today, okay? I might have missed one. But here's a couple things I think we might consider. Number one, I want you all to know that you're invited. Okay? You're invited. No one can leave here and say, I didn't get an invitation. You are invited. Number one, you're invited to step into a relationship with Jesus. I don't know if everyone in this room has made that decision to say, I want to follow Christ. I want him to be my Lord. I want him to be my Savior. If you've never taken that step and said, I want to be a disciple of Jesus, you can come today and say, I'm ready to follow him. We would love to help you take that step. But also, you're invited to be part of a small group. And you have so many options. You can step right. If you haven't already signed up, you can walk out of this door today, go to the right there at the sign-up table, and sign up for one of the small groups. There's a few spaces open. Or you can say, Brad, I want to start a group of my own. I've got two or three friends. That's all it takes. I'd love to start a small group and meet here on Wednesday night. Let me know. Call me. Put it on the communication card, however you see fit, and we'll help you do that. Here's another way you might respond, though. I want to challenge you to walk out of this room today and walk in love as we've described it. It's not about how we feel toward people. It's about how we treat people. Walk in love this week toward your family. Begin to pray for your group that's going to start meeting and say, Lord, help us to walk in love toward each other, to challenge and encourage and press each other toward truth and be patient with each other and kind, to not be self-seeking. And number three, receive this commission. Because if you're in Christ and you've known him and you've walked with him, then friends, this commission is yours to go and be inviters and to invite people to come into whatever opportunities God brings across your path. Maybe it's to invite a friend to church. Maybe it's to invite a person to an event that we have. Or maybe it's to do something with your small group, however that works out. And I just want to throw this in there. Small groups, always be looking for opportunities to do just those fun things that you can invite people into, because it just creates an opportunity. But let's be inviters. Whatever the Holy Spirit's calling you to do today, let's say yes to him, though. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you that you always bless me and floor me with your willingness to take the first step. I'm so grateful, Lord, that you didn't wait on me to get my life together, but you pursued me, you came after me, you put people in my life who pointed me toward you. Lord, help us to be those people for someone else today. Lord, help us to be inviters. Help us to make a fresh commitment to what it means to love one another in Christ today. Lord, as we move toward community and groups, help us to embrace that with an attitude that we're going to grow and challenge each other in what it means to follow you daily as Lord and to love one another as you've loved us and to invite people into that. And Lord, if there's anyone here today who your Holy Spirit has touched and right now they're aware that you died on the cross for them and that you, not me, but you're inviting them to come and receive Jesus, Lord, to become a disciple, to step into a new life. That would be awesome. Wherever you're calling us, however you're drawing us, help us to say yes to you today, Lord, as we sing this song. In Jesus' name, amen.